Good evening, everyone. This is Alamjeet Flora from Porthos Events, bringing you live the Wednesday talk show. This comes every Wednesday to you at 6 o'clock. So thank you for joining us every time. Porthos Events is a Sweden-based company. We are an event management company that, we do a lot of events in education, cultural and entertainment programs in Sweden. And we have now stumbled upon this digital platform, and it's making us very excited as we are able to touch many, many more people. We are able to connect with everyone globally. So it's been an amazing experience for us also as we grow as a company. So thank you so much to all our new viewers. You are supporting us and, you know, following us, giving us your tips. So we are going to keep everything in mind. So thank you so much. Today, we have with us Mr. Nilesh Bajaj. Nilesh is a financial planner and an MBA from University of Pune. He's also a registered investment advisor. He founded the Cedrus Wealth Partners in March 2007, purely to help families. And he has not looked back since. The Cedrus Wealth Partners have grown and have won many awards, including the Business Growth West Awards consecutively for year 2003 and 2004, and also the business, the Best Financial Special Jury Award, CNBC TV 18 for 2016. I'm very proud to introduce Nilesh because I've actually seen his journey from childhood. He's been an amazing wealth manager. So we have done a lot of things together. So I'm actually the one who can actually endorse him to the sense that he's a great planner. So welcome, Nilesh, to Porthos Events. Hello, Nilesh.
Hey, Alam. How are you?
Hi, I'm very good. How are you? Welcome to Porthos Events.
Doing
Sweden.
Good.
Yeah. Thanks. Very, thanks very, very. Thank you, Nilesh. Thank you. Thank you for giving us your time. I know I'm making you sit in office today for longer time, but thank you so much.
It's my pleasure. It's my pleasure for you to invite me to the show.
Yeah, you know, Nilesh, it's our pleasure. And we are going to talk about wealth, which is very interesting for many people, around the globe. And even as you're coming from India, so you also have an Indian perspective on wealth management. So this is a topic that, you know, worries everyone. We are always looking for advice and, seeking a lot of perspectives, how we can manage our wealth, how we can secure the hard-earned money that we do have. So, thank you for coming, because this is going to be a great guidance for all of us, especially we have a lot of viewers coming from Sweden and many have also joined us from India. For the viewers, I would just like to tell you all, if you can write down in the comment box from where you are connecting with us, it'll be really nice. Nilesh, to begin with our first question, I have a few and I'm going to read out to you. So the first one is, what is your take on the current health crisis globally and how is it affecting the economies, in the global sense? Nilesh, your connectivity is a little poor.
Just give me a minute. It's fully connected. Is this fine?
Yeah, this is fine. This is fine. Yeah.
I don't know. Means, I just asked you if it's fine.
Okay. Did you get my question? I just had a question. So did you get that?
I got a bit of it, actually. In fact, okay. I think more to do with the pandemic.
More to do with the pandemic and how it's affecting, the economies globally. There's been a lot of talk and So you are the guy in working with it. So please tell us.
Right. So Alam, the current pandemic has definitely halted the pace, at which the world was moving. In fact, and it's been extremely disruptive. I think, you are lucky you're in Sweden, in fact, whereby, you have not seen the kind of lockdowns which we are seeing in India. In fact, what has happened is, if you ask me, the disruption has been in a positive sense as well as a negative, sense. The positive benefits have been where sectors like digital infrastructure, telecom, pharma, insurance, it disrupted them in a positive way because we have completely changed the way we are actually doing our businesses or the way we are living right now. But there have been a lot of disruption which we have seen in travel, real estate, hospitality, and there are a few more sectors where the disruption has been numerous, in fact. The global economy is surely going to contract substantially this year. I think it's anybody's guess. But specifically, if you ask me now, which countries are going to be, where the disruptions are going to be higher, it's going to be countries like India. In fact, we have seen one of the most strict lockdowns globally. In fact, we are not completely out of the lockdown even today as I'm speaking to you. In fact, so the deceleration is going to be there. Whereas countries like Sweden, where lockdowns have been more lenient, okay, I see no great issues over there actually. So this is how it's going to be. The more the stringent lockdowns, the more the pain the economy is going to have. The lesser the lockdown, or countries like what I told you, like Sweden, we envy you guys because you have not seen too much of a lockdown. And yeah, so the economy is going to bounce back faster than other countries. So 2020 is going to go in history, whereby the business dynamics are definitely going to change, in fact. And it's going there are going to be new norms which are going to be created, and I'm sure everyone is experiencing these new norms. I don't think so we would have been doing these video shows had the lockdown not been there. Okay, I'm talking to all my investors on VC now. Even if they are in local guys, we are talking to them on VC. We don't want to meet them. But I think this is going to benefit a lot of industries also. Okay, but there are is going to be pain for a few sectors like travel, hospitality, and it's going to go on for years. I don't think these sectors are going to come down, come out of this crisis in a great hurry, in fact. So this is my basic take on how the global economy is going to fare post the pandemic, in fact.
Okay, so a lot of effect, but a lot of changes, a lot of learning. So the world is of course changing. Look at us, we've come digital now. So yeah, you answered it rightly. Just talking about the rally in the global equity markets in spite of this bleak growth prospects, they are increasing joblessness as it's affecting the markets, like you said. So what is your take on that? What is the
I'll tell
reason?
you something very interesting, actually. Between April and June, I think the global markets, I'm talking on average, some moved higher than the average, some were lower. But on an average, the Indian equity, the global equity markets, they rose by about 20 to 25%. Okay. Whereas the expected degrowth is close to 20% globally. So I think the markets, if you look at it in pure economic perspective, is not behaving the way it should behave. Okay. So now starting with I'll just give you a brief as to how the markets have fared, the equity markets globally actually. They fell dramatically in March when the lockdowns were announced in various countries, and investors expected that there's going to be a global recession as well as the worst slowdown in the century, you can say, in the past 100 years. Okay, and that was the reason why you saw a huge sell-off not only in the Indian in the global equity markets but across all asset classes. So people just wanted to keep money with them. They didn't want to invest in any asset class. This was March for us. Okay. But what has happened is the markets, the equity markets globally have recouped most of the losses which they saw in March and in the mid of April, between mid of April and March, they've recouped most of the losses in the last 4 5 months, in fact. And what has happened where actually, the market should behave this way? You're talking of something which, we are in one of the worst pandemics since the Spanish flu. And why do the markets behave, the way they have behaved, in fact? And I'm sure, there is always an irrationality which is there in the equity markets, but there are some things which a normal investor cannot see actually. So how did this, the first thing let's take it is that why did the markets rise? Okay, so globally, to counter the recession, most of the central bankers across the world, okay, they slashed interest rates. Okay. And in many developed countries, the interest rates were near zero, in fact. This not only they induced a lot of easy money which was flown, from fixed income where the interest rates are zero, okay, and there was a lot of money liquidity which was made available, which actually saw its way into the equity markets. So this is one of the primary reasons, a lot of liquidity being available globally. This is not country specific, but globally, everyone worked in a very orchestrated way, and there was a lot of money which was flowing into the equity markets because of near zero interest rates in quite a few developed countries. The second thing, in fact, is very interesting. I'll give you a quote of there's this investor called Anthony Bolton, in fact, and he says that the most of the equity money is made when things go from bad to less bad. Okay, so what does that mean? Okay, this is what we have actually experienced. We were experiencing that the world is going to come to an end. Okay, there is no end, that we are not going to come out of this recession soon, which may be a possibility, but right now, the markets, what they were expecting, that the scenario is going to be bad, I think there has been a little bit of confidence coming back, with the numbers, quarterly numbers which are coming on the economic front, that the recovery is going to be faster than expected. And that's primarily the reason why the equity markets have performed well, because they express that they are ex it is going to be bad, but not that bad. Okay, so that's how it's going to be, in fact. So the markets are actually doing well because of that reason. Globally, the fundamentals have not changed. Okay, I think only recovery has been faster than what was expected. Okay, and we are definitely not out of the woods. Till the vaccine is out, I guess investors are just reconciling with the reality that this virus is here to stay and we have to move on. Okay, and we have to do businesses. We have to work in a new norm, and that's what currently what we are experiencing, in fact. There have been a few sectors which will actually benefit from this lockdown and the subsequent new norms which is here to stay, in fact. So one is, which I typically call is, our digital infrastructure. So what we are right now doing is something which I'm very sure even 6 months down the line, people didn't think of. Okay, the digital infrastructure space. IT should do well, pharma, telecom, e-commerce. These are the few which I think will do well even going forward from here on. So this is my take on the global equity scenario. Definitely they have run up, but they have moved ahead of fundamentals. But we need to be cautious with valuations increasing, and because we are not out of the pandemic, the crisis is not abated, in fact. So these are a few reasons why where I feel the markets have done have moved up the way they have.
Okay, thank you so much. Yeah, good to know that at least some hope in some sectors, and hope the others also, revive very quickly because it's impacted lot of business, and also, especially considering the travel industry, which has been impacted a lot. Regarding the Indian equity markets that have risen, substantially by more than 50%. So I'm sure like a lot of non-resident Indians, they would like to know the reason and will this continue like?
Alam, India is definitely at a, it's at a very different stage. It's a very different story actually. And I would like to take some time and explain you the phenomena. And I'm sure, most of our non-resident friends will get a better perspective of what's happening in India, in fact. And we are in very interesting times in India, in fact. And definitely we are in one of the worst lockdowns. So I don't think we are really enjoying this journey, but economically there are a lot of positives which are happening. And I would just tell that like to highlight a few of them, in fact. So as you are aware, we entered this pandemic with the most stringent lockdowns. It disrupted majority of the economy activity for a longer period of time, than other economies. Like most central bankers, which I just reiterate that is that like most central bankers, even the RBI cut interest rates. The interest rates actually, Alam, is at a historical low. We have never seen these kind of interest rates in India. Okay, this, like any other economy globally, has brought in bouts of liquidity into the equity markets. The markets, in fact, in India, has seen a V-shaped recovery. V-shaped means it fell dramatically, it's risen dramatically. Okay, that's called the V-shaped recovery, which was not anticipated at all. We are actually shy of the all-time highs. So India saw the Bombay Stock Exchange, which is the Sensex, that saw a high of 42,000 on the index in February. We are just shy of that 42,000. So you can see the amount of recovery which we have seen from the lows of March, when the markets fell by close to 38%, in fact. Now the thing is, the interesting perspective about India, and that's what I told that, I like to, ponder some, give some more perspectives on India, is that then why is the Indian markets moving when the economy is going to do so badly? In fact, why is this, this market faring so good when you're seeing such so much of pain in the economy, in fact. So I'll just give you a few reasons which I can cite, in fact. One of the reasons is, India always does well when oil prices are low. Okay. Currently we are at very low oil prices globally because of definitely the global pain which we are seeing. There is very little of global trade happening. In fact, our current account position is increasing, it's becoming better because oil contributes about 35% of our overall imports. So what India imports, 35% is oil. Okay. And when you're getting oil at a cheaper rate, India is going to benefit on the on the fiscal and the current account position. It's going to benefit over there. So that is one of the reason. Substantial liquidity has flown in the system. Okay. This is because along with very low interest rates, and the government is supporting the economy, with various liquidity measures, be it for banks, small and medium enterprises, rural economy, small and business, small business houses, everyone is seeing help being provided in form of a moratorium from the government. So the moratorium ends in around September 2020, and many of the sectors actually have got this moratorium help where actually they can repay their, they can start paying off their loans post September. In fact, that's been another reason for it. Now the second part is actually, we have seen a resilient rural demand. Unlike, this is very funny because, I don't think other countries actually have this great divide between rural and urban, what India sees. Today also, India lies in rural rural areas. Okay, India is actually today also the economy is in villages. Okay, agriculture sector it contributes about 36% to the Indian GDP. Okay, and it saw negligible disruption. Okay, so unlike other economies, we have seen that the agriculture sector, because of good monsoons, has seen a negligible disruption, in fact, and that's more to do with rural growth. We have seen a good monsoon last year. That's contributed to a good harvest, one of the best harvests, actually, we have seen in a very long time in India, actually. So that's been one of the primary reasons why the disruption is not going to be as bad as expected. You know, the rural economy is here to save us, in fact. And the good part is that even this year, we have seen a good monsoon. So what's going to happen is there is going to be a good amount of rural demand, you know. And like I told you, growth in India is in rural. It's not in urban, yeah. You know. There is a good amount of rural demand which is there. So India has a lot of demand. But if you divide it, it's actually rural demand, you know. Wow. So, you know, there is where actually the demand comes from. And when they have money in their hands, okay, I don't think it's going to be that bad. Okay. And rural economies have done well, you know. So they didn't have, you know, we were in urban locations. We were sitting at home. You know, we could not move out of our houses when there was a strict lockdown. Fortunately, in rural areas, it was not that bad. And they had done their harvest and they were sitting at, they were chilling out, in fact, compared to, people in the urban locations. So, so that's one of the primary reasons. One more thing is the Indian government, actually, it always, whenever there is support, the support has to be provided to rural areas and for rural employment. So what did the government do? A lot of people talk about unemployment, in fact, being one of the most important part of this pandemic, where there's going to be rampant unemployment, globally.
Yes.
So to support the rural sector, the rural economy for the unemployment, the government came out with MNREGA, where they employed the rural, unemployed people for developing infrastructure. So this is something, one more interesting thing I will tell you is there's a lot of infrastructure activity happening in India, in fact. Mm-hmm. And the good part is I was just talking to one of the persons in this infrastructure sector. He was telling that typically it takes about 3 months to, build that particular amount of, a bridge or something. They do it in about 10 days.
Wow.
Okay. Now, the reason to it is not that the employment is there, but the reason is that no one on the roads. Okay.
Okay.
They don't have to control traffic. Okay.
Yes.
And I think, we are a capital-starved, infrastructure-starved country. And I think, these are the activities which are actually happening and which will definitely be a big positive to, at least in the future.
Yeah.
One more interesting thing is the China effect. I think, in India, like globally, there's been a lot of discontent towards China, in fact.
Yes.
So it's the case everywhere, so they have gifted the world with COVID. Okay. So we need to give it back to them. That's how it was. Okay.
True. I think, everyone's on the same page on this subject.
Absolutely. So when we entered this, in India, when we entered, it was we had the same thoughts, we should, China has given us this and we should give it back to them. We should not buy Chinese goods and all this.
The next question was that because we're doing so well and everything seems good, positive, we can think positively also in all this, so where could our viewers, our investors, where could they invest? Like, what is a good choice for investment, like gold, equity, fixed deposit? it real estate? Like, there are many options.
Right.
So could you please
Yes.
elaborate, guide?
Yeah. in fact, you need to invest based on your own risk appetite. It's very difficult where to invest right now. Definitely, with interest rates down, I don't think so. Fixed income is a great asset class to be in. Equities is something which is run up, but definitely for anyone who has a long-term perspective should look into investing in equities. I think equity as an asset class will perform well. They can invest in tranches, so they do not have to invest everything when the markets are overheated. Gold looks like a good asset class to be in, at least till the vaccine comes in and we are out of this crisis. So I'm quite positive on gold. Apart from that, I think gold and equities. If you ask me, the two asset classes where people can invest money, you can invest money right now in gold, equities, and tranches. In fact, so but definitely investors should take in mind their time horizon as well as their risk appetite.
Yes, very important. I have a few more questions for you, but I think because we don't have much time, I will go to to our viewers' questions. So there is a question from Kanan Krishnan. Will equity market in India contract again post rise in Europe COVID cases? What is outlook for Indian economy to 2021?
In fact, we are short of time, and I had too much of in fact, I was just going on and on.
No, it's good information. I think just gives us a heads up that we need to call you again. So anyways, let's answer this question.
So coming to actually, how the Indian what I got it right, just correct me if I'm if I've got it right. It's basically what he wants to ask is how is the Indian equity markets expected to do in 2021, the economy is. So yeah, so this year I think we should just discount this year for the economy at least. I don't think any economy is going to do well. India's GDP is expected to contract by 15 to 20%. Indian equities have run up. Okay, you need to be cautious right now, but 2021 onwards, we see a good recovery coming in the Indian economy, and that's the reason why you're seeing the Indian equities also perform well. We expect Indian equities to do well, but definitely you need to be cautious. The markets have moved up in a hurry, so it's better to invest in tranches or every decline than trying to put everything right now, invest everything right now. So I would expect caution, but definitely there is a good amount of growth which is expected post 2021.
Thank you, Nilesh. Next question. Will this rise in Indian equity sustain only on liquidity?
Things are good till liquidity is there. Okay, and but I don't think that's going to sustain. Fundamentals is all what is required to sustain. In fact, any economy, liquidity is not the factor which is going to sustain. The way liquidity comes in, it moves out also the similar way. So when it moves out and there's no fundamental to back it, you are going to see the markets correct also. First thing is it's not going to sustain. Definitely, if it's going to be liquidity driven, but there are strong fundamentals which are going to play out post 2021. We are seeing a lot of reforms happening in India on the labor and on the land front, which is to do with the Atmanirbhar Bharat. If you have heard about this, Atmanirbhar is
Of
self-reliant
course.
India. So
It's
it's
a
called
very
self-reliant India, in fact. So there are a lot of positive reforms which are coming in line with this, whereby the government is trying to make the Indian industry self-reliant and we should not be dependent on imports. So this is something to do with our neighbors, actually. So I think we will be doing good post 2021, and the markets will sustain only if there are positive signs on that front.
Good. Thank you so much. We have a last question that we'll take from you is from Sandeep. He's asking about Reliance Industry. What is the outlook of Reliance Industry in 5 years? I think he's an investor. So
I would just like to first comment that I don't give stock advice on a common platform, okay, on a public platform. I can just give him some, some perspectives about what Reliance is doing, and he needs to take a call whether he should stay invested or not stay invested or buy shares. Okay,
so
my whole sell strategy is going to be his. I can just give him some data actually to take some decision. So Reliance, the first and most important thing, have almost virtually become debt free. They have seen a lot of equity getting induced in their Jio platform and Reliance Retail, in fact. So Jio platform, actually, they sold about, I'm not sure, but it must be about 20% of Jio platform. And the whole of Reliance Industries, which has a debt of about close to 1,60,000 crores, okay, just by selling a 20% stake in Jio platforms and by coming out with the right issue, they have become virtually debt free. So that's going to improve the bottom line. Second is basically they are now doing a similar thing with Reliance Retail. Once Reliance Retail also gets interest, and there has been a lot of interest from global players, I think Reliance over a period of next 1 to 2 years, their balance sheets will be definitely very strong, in fact. So it's led the way in this rise. So the leader actually in this rise from 27,000 to 39,000 has been primarily Reliance. Going ahead is going to be based on getting back to numbers, actually how their quarterly numbers are going to look like. So that's what I can talk about Reliance.
Okay. Great. Thank you so much. We've had a great session, a lot of questions coming and a lot answered, so much perspective on, Indian and global market that you gave us. So thank you so much, Nilesh, for your time. We hope to have you back to get more details again. So I will contact you. So thank you so much for today and good night to you. Have a good sleep. Take care.
Thanks, Alan. You take care.
Thank you. Hello, friends. This is Alamjeet again here with you. And thank you so much for joining us today. We are going to be back next week with Ayon Chakrabarty. Ayon is, he is inspiring us so much to do so much good that we, we have started Pothos with health and then we spoke about wealth. But when we have health and wealth, we think we should do something good with it. And Ayon is correctly on the right track. He is, has a organization called Setu Swerya Foundation. He's doing amazing work. And I think we all should join hands to help him and do our bit to encourage such endeavors. So please join us next week as we meet Ayon and know more about his foundation and how he's doing such great job. So thank you so much. Have a great evening and see you next week on the Wednesday Talk Show. Bye.